Okay, so Jamal Nyaz here with AJ Bowen, finally meeting face to face at Grimmfest.
Like we're old friends at this point after doing Zoom from my living room.
I know. So. It was a pleasant surprise to hear that you was gonna be here. It was sort of a last minute thing, wasn't it?
Same for me too, because I mean I recorded a Q&A for the screenings.
Oh really?
And so I didn't know if last night if it was gonna be. When I did we had our first screening last night, I didn't know if I was going to be talking to myself on the screen while I was standing in front of it. But yeah, I've been discussing with Simeon and a couple of the other guys about like, hey, I've been wanting to come to the UK my whole career. I feel like I'm supposed to be from here. I feel like a stranger in America. Is there anything we can do? You know, I'll clean tables, I'll wash dishes. So that it worked out. So it was really great to get to be here.
So you said you saw the screening last night. Yeah. What was that reaction like? That must have been awesome.
It was really positive, and I really appreciate it. And I think that we spoke before about how one of the blessings of getting to make movies that play internationally or that, you know, that play globally is there's such different responses in minor cultural ways that this particular movie doesn't fit into a box. And I've done ones where they're like, okay, that's a slasher. This is an old school throwback horror film. This is an atmospheric horror film. This is a slow burn, but this one's so different that it's sort of on the outer expanses of what can be considered. It's definitely genre, which you talked about, but yeah. Like, I don't know if it's a horror film.
Horror.
Yeah. And I would say that, you know, based on what I've done and the fact that I'm a lifelong horror watcher, that it's not. Mm. And in America, that can be an issue where people have an expectation of, you know, like, if I'm in a movie, then I probably need to be choking somebody out or stabbing somebody. And so, you know, getting a little bit older and playing, getting to do something different that fits more tonally the sort of stuff that I'm into as a creator.
Yeah.
Where there's it's got that, but then it has other things. In America, it's not that people shit on it, but it wasn't quite. Some people are like, I don't get it.
Yeah.
But it's so interesting to go somewhere like the UK and to play it in Manchester and have audiences accept that and be interested in that it's something that's different, that isn't paint by numbers.
Yeah.
So seeing that and having it just be like a great, like, regular response where you don't even have to sort of qualify and express why we did what we did, and people are just being into it is awesome.
Yeah. And then just in terms of the reactions, did you have any chats with any of the audience members outside of the showing?
Yeah.
What was some of the best quotes that you'd heard from some of the fans last night?
Quotes.
Anything that stood out to you?
Someone asked me, a fellow filmmaker who was watching it during the Q&A asked me if we discussed whether or not to put QAnon issues in it, which I found to be really strange. I don't even know if people talk about QAnon out here. The movie is basically a discussion between a millennial and a Gen X person, yeah. Like arguing. And I don't know at what point in time I became the old man, but I did. And so every discussion starts from that place. Music, whether or not to pay for art, yeah. Which is something that like a lot of, like, I know the actor that was in the movie across from me, and she doesn't believe in paying. I don't want to shit on her, but she comes up from a time when paying for art is not something that everybody does. I mean, they'll pay for a ticket to the movies, but like they don't pay for music. Mm. And I come from an older generation. It's like you have to pay for everything when it comes to that. So there were some questions that people asked me about, you know, like there were quotes, I'm not sure, but like people asking, well, what would you do in this situation? I'm like, well, I think it's all up there. It's pretty close. People expressing disbelief that this guy would continue to go along with it. And I'm like, well, you've never been poor then, because I have, and I would absolutely continue doing it.
Yeah.
But no, it was great. It was great to talk to some people who've also seen some of the other work that I've done, because I've been fortunate to have it play over here.
Yeah.
And getting to talk about different movies. I had a guy come up who knows that I love Christmas horror, and he had brought DVDs for me of things, and he had questions about, like, so what about this character? I had a guy bring up some pages that he'd written down of notes where it was like best sex scene that you're in, which is a little strange, but but I appreciated it.
Yeah.
And I knew exactly what he was going to say. But yeah, getting through like a chart of like best ponytail in a movie for you as a character. And wow. I was like, I didn't even know that there were enough of those for me to have a best of and a worst of. But
this guy should do an interview with you. He's got more interesting questions for you than I have.
Interesting, yes. Yeah. Yes, interesting, yes. Uncomfortable slightly, but no, it was fine.
So we mentioned last time about how different it was for you as an actor to go in that intimate setting. Most of the time it's just you and one other person throughout the whole film. For you, looking back on that, you know, you watched the film last night. What was that experience like in comparison to a big ensemble film like Your Next, where celebrating 10 years of that this week?
I know, it's wild. I was at home getting my kiddo to bed. I have a 7-year-old, and I was getting her to bed, and I saw that there was like a 10th anniversary in LA at Beyond Fest, and I was like, oh my God, I got so into dad zone that I didn't even know what was going on. I didn't even know what was happening. And then I was like, 10 years? Oh shit, yeah, it's been 10 years, I can't believe this. That, like, specifically, like, Your Next was designed to be a film festival audience movie, right. The sort of thing that is a midnighter. I remember we had done a movie before, those guys and I, called A Horrible Way to Die, and we played it at Toronto, and it's a very dark film, it's sad, it's morose, I love it, but it's the sort of movie that and I've done a few of these, where it gets done and the audience is... they enjoyed watching it, but they also never want to see it again.
Yeah,
you know, they feel a little down after it, and they're certainly not feeling like partying.
No.
You know, when it gets done.
Yeah.
So Your Next was designed to be a thing where, because when we were there with A Horrible Way to Die, James Wan was there with Insidious, so the guys got to see our audience reaction to a film about addiction and a serial killer that's depressed about being a serial killer. It's very sad, and everyone just quietly sort of filed out after that film, thinking it was great and we really appreciated it, but they also we had also given them depression. So the guys went into a screening of Insidious and saw the audience reaction to that and saw how much there was like high-fiving and enjoying that process of same sort of stuff that, like, for me, I'm in my mid-40s, so the feeling of watching movies, I still remember the first Friday the 13th that I got to go to, and it didn't matter that it was a terrible one. It was still just like, I can't believe I'm here in the theater watching a movie with other people that like horror films. So Your Next was designed to do that. And this one, you know, like, I sort of jumped back and forth between them. So Your Next was that, and then the next one that came out was The Sacrament, which is another, like, don't feel good about yourself or the state of the world kind of a thing. And this one is intended to be a bit more light, entertaining, but also for us, and without spoiling it, it's specifically one that was designed to watch more than once, so that it's a completely different film. When you see Charlotte's performance after knowing everything, what Charlotte's doing the next time you watch the movie is a completely different experience.
Yeah.
And it was great to see people really enjoy the twist and to see people laughing with it and feeling entertained by it and not depressed, it's nice to get back to that.
Nice bonus.
Yeah, feeling good. There's enough going on in the world. We don't need to make any depressing art right now.
Yeah.
So,
And then when you mentioned those films like The Sacrament, Your Next, what you're working with guys, we had a brief discussion last time on Zoom, working with guys like Ty West and Adam Wingard. What they've achieved in the genre, what you've achieved with them, did you know within the first instances of meeting those guys, and like Joe Swanberg as well, I said to you that I was fortunate enough to watch VHS, which a lot of those guys had worked on that. The new one of that is out coincidentally right now. Did you know that they were going to go on to achieve what they did?
It's strange. It's like you never know. You know when you find somebody is talented. And I knew right off the jump, the reason that I worked with Ty was that I had a movie called The Signal that we were traveling festivals with at the same time that Ty had a movie called The Roost. And we kept bumping into each other at the same festivals, South by Southwest and other places. And we became friends in LA. So all these guys lived in Los Angeles, but we were all traveling. We had never met. And after a few festivals, you start finding out that you're interested in the same sorts of things, but you're also having issues like raising financing for a film. And that group of people, and like to go back to Your Next, people like Amy Simons and Swanberg and Ty acted in that movie, but they're primarily directors. And me, I'm known in the genre as an actor, but equal to that, I'm a producer and a writer as well. So having everybody figure out, oh, we can, like, I've done sound on movies, I've gripped movies. And so having a crew of people that can do all of those jobs allows you to do a lot more for less money. And when Ty was getting ready to do House of the Devil, he was originally going to play the part that I played. And then he thought, oh, that may be too much for me dealing with this, because this is the first movie I'm making that has a budget attached to it. So he asked me if I wanted to fly out and do it. And I was like, of course. So getting to be on set and see how he operated, I knew instantly with Ty. I was like, well, Ty really knows what he's doing technically, and he knows how to handle the breakdown of a crew and how to really pre-plan. So I knew that Ty was going to be fine. And seeing the growth, I've gotten to make movies with first-time filmmakers or early filmmakers, and sort of try to help shepherd the content or massage it. And seeing that, doing that with A Horrible Way to Die, and seeing these guys start to blossom, that crew, you know, like you're saying, like Joe, like with VHS, and then it just kept exponentially jumping up, and getting to see how, because I was in the guest, but I came in for reshoots for like a day, because they needed somebody to, you know, help explain what was going on in part of the movie. And they were like, oh, well, he did that in your next, we'll just get AJ to do it again for the guest. So seeing the leaps that they were making, like from A Horrible Way to Die to Your Next, and then from Your Next to The Guest, I was not surprised at all to see them doing Blair Witch. I was a little surprised. I think anyone would be, and this is nothing against Wingard, but like, I was a little surprised to see the guy that we made a $10 movie with, lit entirely by Christmas lights, directing Godzilla vs. Kong. Yeah. That was a trip. You know, it was a trip to see all that stuff. And especially, like, you know, it came out during the pandemic, so I have my kid at home, and being like, yeah, I made a movie about addiction with that guy for $10, and now he's got Godzilla in it. So I'm not surprised. I'm grateful that these guys that are good dudes, that are really talented, like Amy working with Soderbergh and getting to work with Ridley Scott on an Alien film. I mean, I'm jealous.
Yeah.
But it's wonderful to see, because they're good people and they're great creatively. So it was going to happen, you know, that just at some point in time they were going to start growing their careers. So
if those sorts of roles come to you, obviously you mentioned Adam doing the Kong vs. Godzilla film, you would definitely jump at that opportunity, would you? Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. I like eating expensive food. Yeah. No, I would absolutely do it. And it's funny that they're doing it, because I'm the one that has, out of that group of people, that has always had mentally a bit more of a mainstream sensibility about the work. I'm like, I would do a big movie.
Yeah.
Like, I want to be Jason Bourne.
Yeah.
Like, you know, like those sorts of things. You know, like we were talking about Bond, and I'm like, I love doing indies. That's the world that I live in and have for almost two decades. But I'm also like, I would be really happy to do a Richard Curtis film, you know. So it's like,
is that something that you're actively going to start looking for, or,
you know, I don't probably not. Like, if it happens, it happens. But a long time ago, things sort of shifted into being more. I think of it, and I don't know if we talked about this before, but I think of it more as I'm an indie rock guy.
Right.
So like, I'm an indie band kind of guy. I'm touring in the van, and that's sort of. And part of it is out of necessity, because my sense of creativity is more DIY, like do it yourself. Don't wait for somebody to cut you a check. In college, we made choices early on, like how do I tell a story with what I've got, instead of waiting to get things to tell a story. Because a lot of what I was inspired by were people, you know, like my buddy Don Coscarelli, when he made Bubba Hotep. He was concerned about getting it out there, because already at that point, and I didn't know him then, but distribution models were starting to change, and he took a page out of Romero's playbook with Night of the Living Dead and struck a film print and toured college campuses with it. And that made that movie immortal. And so that's sort of how I've always done it. That's how we've sort of always done things. Like with this one, with Night Drive, we knew that we could take the time, we could wait and seek financing, and we would get it, but it would be 3 years, because that's how it works when you're not in the studio system, where it's just ready to be immediately greenlit and into production. And we all have lives and kids and jobs, and they work with Marvel and Disney, so cutting out a window when we could get it done was more important than doing it for more money. And on top of that, when they're working with Marvel and Disney, which they love to do, they have several bosses. And having bosses can get in the way of telling, of creative storytelling, you know? So I would rather do something for $100 instead of $1,000 if it means that it's more us and that we don't answer to people. And for better or for worse, like if there's criticism, it's on us. It's not on somebody in a suit that wrote a check that has no idea what we were trying to do. You know, that's on me. If we made a mistake with it, then I'd rather that be on us, and as well as the responsibility for getting the movie done and being able to see this group of artists' perspective. And that happens in the indie world. And I am so used to that being the case, I'd probably become a prick if somebody started having questions about some of the stuff that I'm used to. Like, we already get into arguments with distributors about, like, no, we already designed the poster.
Yeah.
We already cut a trailer. We don't need you guys to do that for us again.
Yeah.
But that's just standard, you know? So even that can be tricky. So I would jump in happily. I would love to see what craft services look like on a $60 million movie.
Yeah, you know?
And what it's like to work 3 hours a day. That would be amazing.
Yeah.
Instead of 21 hours in a
wow.
day. But also, this is the life I lead. And this is, I know that at this point that if I put something out, that there's an audience that has seen enough of it that knows that, okay, well, this group of people is, they're going to have done the best job that they can, and more times than not, we do okay with it. And so I value that deeply, and I wouldn't want to give that up.